And welcome to Microsoft Virtual Academy. I'm Brandon Matherson, and I'm a product marketing manager at Microsoft, focused on the Windows Server System Center and Azure Data Center Solutions team, focused on how we actually deploy and provide a holistic data center solution, a manager environment within IT. So thus far, I'm inside the automation and self-service session, and currently we're going to be talking about system automation. And this is where we're going to take advantage of the depth and insight into orchestrator automation, which allows us to be able to create workflows, or we call them runbooks, to kick off processes and activities that we typically have done manually in the past, but now we want to bring to life all the richness with automation. So let's dig into what does this look like from an automation perspective. So the first thing that I want to cover is on how we actually, the tenets of what we think about in terms of deploying the cloud services in an automated fashion. So the first thing is, we identify what customers have been coming to us and with what they want to do, and what are the things that they really want to drive, and what's important to them. Organizations are all about the ability to manage and control change. Changes are occurring consistently. Requests come in over time. We're growing in our data needs. We're growing in the amount of users that we need to support coming in and going out of the organization. And then we want to save time and resources. What does it cost us to actually provide those resources? Who do I need to have on staff to be able to deliver those resources? There's something that IT is being really mindful about. So those are the things that we want to make sure that we cover. We want to implement a consistent process, or let's think about this in terms of standardization, being able to deliver the same thing the same way all the time. Now, what does change is scale and scope and some of the specs, but how we go back to the business with those services is consistently the same. And then we want to minimize risk. We want to reduce error. As we introduce more manual tasks, we increase risk. So those are the primary things that we've been chartered with in terms of thinking about our orchestrator or automation solution. Now, with runbooks, as I call these as workflows, is used to control the system tasks. So think service manager in terms of the processes. Now we're thinking about the systems themselves or the components. What needs to be implemented in order for a service to be delivered? And we want to make sure that we standardize that process for those users as well. So automation provides the resources that are provisioned the same way all the time, as I mentioned, is going to help us reduce those costs. We're going to take advantage of the CMDB or the Configuration Management Database to identify the systemic issues or problems or potential problems that may occur within the environment, because we've applied all those rich processes and that schema, and we're able to march towards that as we think about automated tasks. Then we want to enable the IT resources and staff to focus on what they do best and what they deliver back to the business to create that value for the organization. So we deliver the service delivery model through automation in a number of ways. First is the automation at the outset, but what do we have on the back end of that? Because automation is all about automating processes within the CMDB, the requests, the approvals, all the way through to fulfillment. And we take advantage of routing the requests and then provisioning those service requests as needed as we see users coming to us with their demands. Now, that empowers the standardization piece, and the standardization is all about how we provide this in the form of templates or the form of service offerings or request offerings, because then we're able to kick off commands within Orchestrator through those runbooks to say, here's what steps need to happen next. Here's what service requests or request offerings I need to ping, or which templates I need to engage along the path of resolution. And then ultimately, it's the self-service experiences where the user is able to get access to that request directly without having to go to a physical person. So that's the components that we see that we'll march towards in this view. Now, Orchestrator, as the automator, and this is what is the key component to automating tasks, is all about providing service management. It's all about protection, provisioning, configuration, as well as monitoring can all be pieces of what we orchestrate. And these are all elements that we see within the stack. Service management is where we get the richness of service manager. Provisioning is where we're taking advantage of our investments in virtual machine manager. Configuration will be where we see what we've been comfortable with in terms of configuration manager. Monitoring is going to be operations manager, and then protection when we want to think about data protection manager as well. So we see this as the automator in the middle that's connecting these pieces, but we're also, let's not forget that we're also built in third-party connectivity with other solutions or components that which you may have in your environment, which takes advantage of both that heterogeneous as well as homogeneous solutions that you may want to implement within your environment. So the components of the orchestrator piece, it looks a bit like this. You notice in the middle I have these runbooks, I have these jobs, these tasks, and I have these logs. Now, connected to each one of those, when you think about how do I actually deploy or install or set up orchestrator within my environment, I'm going to have my runbook servers, where these are going to be the servers which contain my actual workflows, the steps, and where I might access runbook designer and the like as well. You'll see my management server, which is where I will have all of my data and information around managing my server, and then runbook designer and tester itself. So there's a big connectivity between runbook designer and then the runbook servers themselves. Orchestrator also has a web service piece of it as well, which enables me to be able to do web-based services such as REST or even the orchestration console as well, which can be delivered in that web service. So that's the basic architecture or structure of the orchestrator module. Now, I don't want us to forget about the role that PowerShell plays in this, because we're now taking advantage of .NET scripting as an activity within Orchestrator. So when I'm going into my Runbook Designer, I can start to bring in a lot of the rich scripts that I've already created within my environment. I don't have to start from scratch, but it gives me a GUI interface, a real cool graphical view of how I start to bring together all of these steps while taking advantage of the actual scripts that are on the underlying piece of the automation. So as I think about how that architecture works, let's take a look at the runbook automation and management itself, and what the components are that brings that together. I have my activities. If you notice on the left, I have a number of activities, and I can show this in Orchestrator in a moment, of tasks that I want to perform, incremental steps that I want to go, that I want to do to be able to deliver a full service. Then I have some standard activities that are going to be embedded within in my environment. And then I have the runbooks themselves, and runbooks will look exactly like you see here, a number of next step arrows. If something fails, go another direction. If something succeeds, continue on. That's kind of this view in a graphical perspective in how we deliver that. The pieces of the automation lie in four basic categories. One are the activities, the runbooks, the data bus, and the standard activities. Within the activities which we saw previously is where I can think about, I want to invoke a web service, I want to query a database, I want to send an email, or even I want to return some data so I can use that moving forward. I then have my runbooks. I bring those together to create the runbooks in which I want to create an incident or create a checkpoint or shut down a VM, maybe one of the steps that I want to do. I also want to call out here, we're also able to bring runbooks inside of runbooks, and that's what's called a nested runbook. And that's why I want to take advantage of some work that I've already created some basic tasks, but I want to link those tasks together to then deliver that service across a broader set of systems or a broader set of environments. The data bus is what I'm going to use to actually publish and consume information that the runbook actually executes on. And I may have a certain list of commands that you may see, such as you want to get some data sources or some inputs that we need to get from our users. and one of the steps that we're going to perform. So we want to use a data bus to be able to take advantage of how we're going to pass information along and use it across our different components, whether it be virtual machine manager or whether it be service manager. I then have my standard activities, and this is basically out of the box activities or steps that I want to take advantage of that we have within the environment. We can take a look at what that looks like in a moment. I'm then able to think about how do I actually get those runbooks or those workflows to a point where I can actually deliver them and execute them within my environment and have them perform as expected. One, I'm going to have my sandbox environment. I want to make sure I test. And then I'm going to go back into my sandbox and run that some more. I'll go to a pre-production phase before I get into production. So we're going to use the capabilities of checking out our runbooks and making sure we're checking them back in and performing those steps and testing them. And I can actually do incremental tests along the way in each one of those tasks or steps that I'm going to be doing. Within that data bus is one of the ways that I'm going to be able to bring data across one set of steps to the next. And that's going to be very key as we think about how do we actually take advantage of the activities, write information that we've received from those activities, and then read that information and the output and be able to execute on that and across our systems. That could be potentially very helpful if we think about using nested runbooks or runbooks inside of runbooks, because then we can go deeper into automation and decision points when we have more complex tasks. If we think about expanding capacity, it'd be very, very simple in terms of identifying what the resource is, where the VM is, what is the VM and what I want to expand it to versus maybe a more comprehensive set of steps that I want to do when, let's say, when I bring on board a new user and we have to do a number of different things in terms of setting up an environment for them, giving them permissions, giving them the appropriate capacity, and then providing them with a way to create incidents and get access to the service portal and make requests. So that set of steps can be considered more of a nested view or a nested runbook approach. So then we'll be able to use that modular approach to then see them as building blocks to build on those steps as we move forward. It also creates efficiencies because many times I can forget steps if I'm doing this manually, or it can delay or introduce more lead time into delivering services back to our end users. And then the smaller nested runbooks can ease the ongoing of authoring and troubleshooting as I may want to resolve some potential issues I may have in my process. And that's basically why we would use those runbooks moving forward. Now, what makes those work is another step in and of itself is because we can then initiate a runbook from within another using the invoke runbook activity. That's one of the activities that helps us to be able to call another runbook. So as I start to link them together, I use the invoke runbook to be able to perform those steps. And I have a real basic example of what that looks like in a moment. We can also publish and describe the data bus as a mechanism to pass that information from one activity to the next within the same runbook. So that's basically how we see that working. But let's take a look at what this looks like within Orchestrator. For instance, you'll see this is a basic runbook that I have up front where I have a number of steps that I'm going to actually walk through. And I want to trigger a child runbook to basically create a file, and then I want to submit a couple of parameters to that. So the first thing you're going to see is I'm going to step into the runbook and I see I want to trigger the file create activity. So that's where I'm going to define the custom start for the trigger for the child of the file creation step. I then move over and then I see a couple of things that you'll see here loop back and forth is where now I'm going to verify or I'm going to review that child workflow and make sure that it's done by checking the existence of a text file. I've created some text file and it has a string of data and I want to make sure that it's correct. And that helps me define the source file and get the file. I can then define the exit condition for that loop because I have a loop there. I don't want to continue moving forward there going in circles. So I can define when I want to exit that loop and define the file and the lines that I want to read from within that runbook. Okay. The last thing I want to do, I want to trigger that the child workflow in terms of the file deletion step. And so now I can submit the name and the path of the file as a parameter. This helps me to define the policy and custom start for that trigger policy. And that's something that really helps us move through the process of using runbooks inside of runbooks. And you'll see the icon there is a separate runbook in and of itself and where I've created the file. And then I went through, validated the information that's there, and I deleted that file. And this is all done within Orchestrator to deliver that end-to-end of the runbooks. To author if we think about authoring, this is where we're actually creating our own runbook. And let's say we might have a blank canvas, let's say, and we're going to create a picture. We're going to create a workflow that goes through a number of different steps. It can be very simple to very complex. So when I do this, I'm going to take advantage of the authoring tools, the data bus, as well as the integration packs. On the right side of the window, you'll see a number of the basic standardized tasks, as well as a number of the integration packs that we've been able to bring in, which are IPs for System Center, our basic Microsoft stack, as well as third-party management tools, if you so choose, which helps you be able to identify certain tasks, certain steps, certain actions or objects, and then you can take advantage of our debugging tools as well to debug when does this go wrong, and I can test this before I check this particular runbook in. For instance, when I come through some of my activities, there are some standard ones that we have listed here, but let's say we can run some .NET scripting, we can run a program, or we can run some other commands, and we can build on that to build out a step of activities that we would like to run within the environment. Okay. Now, when I'm also in Runbook Designer, I also have some other tools, such as the Quick Integration Toolkit, which helps us to be able, a cool wizard-based GUI that helps us be able to map the steps and the integration tasks that we have within the runbook themselves. So this is something that you can also take advantage of when you're in the designer itself. So let's take a look at what this looks like within Orchestrator, and I can show you where you can find this information when you step into an Orchestrator environment of your own. What we're going to do now, we're going to look at Orchestrator and we're going to step into the window and just look at what are the options I have available to me when I want to create a runbook. I have some runbooks that I've already created, but I'll actually look at some of the tasks that I have available there. So here I am within Orchestrator. When I open up Orchestrator Runbook Designer, I now have a set of runbooks that I already have identified here, but on the right side, let's pay attention here. This is where all of those runbook activities already exist. I have, I can end a process, I can monitor an SNMP trap, I can query a WMI, I can restart a system, run a .NET script as we saw before. But then as I scroll down as well, I have more third-party tools. You'll see some tools here that I have for BMC. I have some Covarian tools. I'll have some Remedy tools, HP. And then, of course, all of my System Center tools I have here as well. And if I click on any one, let's say Configuration Manager, you'll see I'll have some steps that I can perform there where I can create a collection. I can delete a collection rule. I can come into Service Manager and create change with the template. So now I'm thinking about ways that I can start to integrate and come into, let's say, Service Manager to create some steps and take advantage of the policies that I've built there. So this is the basic canvas for what an Orchestrator Runbook Designer may look like. And we'll come back to this and look at what is some more information around the actual components or objects that you see listed here. So moving along, when we think about extensibility, and we've heard a little bit about this with some of the integration packs that we have, and in our integration section, we'll talk more around what specific integration packs exist and what we can take advantage of, but we also have built-in extensibility and PowerShell integration, and that's where we're taking advantage of our .NET scripting. If we want to think about some C# and some PowerShell, we really have a rich set of activities that we can start to take advantage of, as you saw, we were just within the tool a moment ago. And you see a number of those activities there, and this is where we can start to bring in that richness that we've seen in other tool sets that may pre-exist in your environment today, and you can use them here directly within Orchestrator, within System Center, to automate your activities. But why PowerShell? That's something that we get asked and something that we want to consider is extension flexibility, and this is how we can really take advantage of the deep workflows that we already may build out within PowerShell, and we're able to leverage that for easy automation, and we leverage the Orchestrator data bus are the key pieces of why we may want to use the extensibility through PowerShell integration. Some of the things that we're going to be able to do with PowerShell within a runbook, I have some bullet points here that some things that we can do, but we can use PowerShell to create local variables. We can also execute, dedicate to a dedicated runbook server and use a variable that's not name-based, or we can export runbooks before we want to edit them and the like. So these are some of the things that we can do within PowerShell within the runbook. As you go through this course, you can take advantage of, we have some more supporting information and in the appendix that you can take with you to learn more around what some of those steps are as you go through the course. Now, when I'm extending with PowerShell is where I want to use PowerShell perhaps when I don't have all the necessary integration packs that I may hope to have in the future. You can definitely take advantage of some runbooks and some integration packs that are out there through CodePlex, but we also have some variables that you can take advantage of within PowerShell and want to use that within the data bus. So this is something that will help you to leverage your scripting capabilities and your scripting expertise where integration packs might not meet the need or might not exist currently. But an end-to-end process, when we think about how are we going to actually deliver some services or deliver some resources back to the enterprise, you'll see a number of different categories on the left. Right? I want to do some event management. I want to do some service desk activities, some asset or configuration activities, some virtualized infrastructure needs, storage, network, compute, etc. may all be some things that I'm going to want to have to do. But then you'll see, and then have a number of different steps that I want to make sure that I standardize across along the way. And I can build out that process through a number of different steps all the way through to completion. So I want to monitor for an error. I want to initiate some change. And that's what I'm going to take advantage of my CMDV. I want to create a deployment where I want to take advantage of what's in my configuration steps. I want to send that VM into maintenance mode. I want to create an extra disk. I want to go verify all of that information and then provide an update back to the CMDV and then close that request. So I've been able to provide a simplified way to meet our SLA demands. We want to make sure that we're in compliance along each one of those steps because I built in the necessary thresholds for my compliance needs, and then I can trace where that process might break down. I've increased productivity. I've been able to use my best practices to build this process, but then been able to provide a clear return on investment as I've been able to do all of these steps in a seamless manner without doing them individually as we've done in the past. So moving forward with how do we actually automate the service deployment, and this is where we actually have a runbook and we want to actually see how do we actually walk through the process of the end user getting that service as they expect it to be delivered. So using Service Manager and Orchestrator, I'm going to deploy services and implement a change. So I want to provision some VMs. So some of the things I'm going to have to do are I'm going to need to define the VM attributes and connect to the application deployments in a correct manner. So let's take a look at a runbook that we have here where I'm going to initiate some data, initiate some information about it. I'm going to definitely want to create the VM from a template. Remember, within Service Manager is where we have all those rich templates of activities that I want to take advantage of. Now, the next steps that you'll see in here, once I start my VM, I'm going to be able to link the application deployments. So I want to make sure that is my SQL Server requested? If it is, and I want to add a SQL collection to that, I want to make sure that's refreshed, and then connect to that client. So I've gone through some of the processes of coming in, deploying a service, using Service Manager, stepping in a Service Manager, starting that VM, and then ensuring that my SQL application has been applied and I've been able to refresh that service and deliver that back to the customer. The next thing is let's think about database as a service where I want to map a runbook and its parameters, enable it in the web portal. So you'll see when you're coming into Orchestrator, you'll have a number of runbooks that you may have already created. Now, what you can do within your environment, you can take advantage of some sample runbooks that we have out there on CodePlex that look exactly like we've seen in the console that I've just showed a moment ago. And I can go back into that and take a look at what some of those parameters are. But you can do the same as you want to think about deploying a database as a service or providing a solution to your end customers via the runbook workflow. Once you do that, you can then create that as an offering within Service Manager. So if you look at what customers may see when they go to the self-service portal, you can create that as a service and you can step right into Service Manager, allow users to go in and request all the attributes that they need to see to request that service. And once they do that, they'll see it in the service catalog and then they'll be able to have that available to them. The last step there is then the application deployment itself is where you want the runbook to install the package and deploy it to the service catalog. And that's where you'll actually create this runbook, and we have an example of a runbook here, and you have this all at your fingertips following this session once you download all of the necessary information for this, and we have all the links through TechNet as well where you can get these same runbooks to start playing with. And again, if you notice, this particular runbook that we have up right now is an example of a nested runbook where I've taken advantage of runbooks that I've already created and been able to apply in these steps. And again, I've created that runbook and I've now provide application deployment as a service request that end users can use in their self-service experience. Now, workstations in Ops Manager is another one that will enable us to be able to request an offering that kicks off a runbook workflow. That's another step that we can take advantage of our integration within Operations Manager to be able to perform some of these steps. And you'll see this workflow or these workstations being able to have a number of steps that can be performed on them and services requested against them within the service catalog. So what you've seen is I've been able to, I've gone from deploying the application as a service within the Service Manager self-service portal. Then I've treated the workstations as a mechanism to deliver some services against them because I want to do some maintenance or I want to do some checking or changes in the provisioning of those solutions or components. And I've delivered that to them via a runbook. And that runbook has been able to call out the necessary steps to get that information to end customers. So those are the steps that we've seen deploying a number of different services, provisioning VMs, setting up database as a service, deploying an application as a service, or providing those workstations as a service for additional maintenance or requested services that users may have. looking at another one is, let's scale a service across a web form. And this is something that we can do solely within Orchestrator as well. And this is a runbook that's been created and is available through our community to be able to detect and scale and automatically provision VMs as we need them. So that's kind of the first thing that we need to do, is identify where we need to actually identify where we need to provision additional VMs. We have too many connections, and we're getting a synthetic transaction issue. We've thrown an alert. There's an alert that's come up, and we've identified it within the web form. We know that we need to make some adjustments because we have an environment. It's at capacity, or it's reaching its threshold. We're getting some errors or some issues. We want to look for those issues. So we create an object here that helps us find that information. And then the next thing that we want to do is we want to implement some changes. So this is where we start thinking about our change management process. We have this runbook. We've identified an issue. We want to invoke a change, and we want to call out where we need to kick off an additional runbook or where we need to implement change using our investments that we have in Service Manager. And we want to create some change, a change management process for that item. Now, once we do that, we want to make sure that we also provide a mechanism that this change is approved, because what we don't want to occur is that we build out all of these runbooks, and we don't want to get to a point where they're unmanaged or we don't know what's occurring in the environment. We want to make sure that we build in the necessary approvals for what can be changed within the environment. And this is where a runbook can have an object where it actually checks for those necessary approvals, then executes the change process once that item has been approved. So that kind of sums up what we can deliver from a deployment perspective in terms of deploying a process, deploying a service using Orchestrator or using Service Manager and Orchestrator together. That would be the primary piece that helps us be able to do this. Let's step back in and look in Orchestrator in terms of what this actually looks like within the console of Runbook Designer as well as in Service Manager. So I'm going to click over back into Orchestrator and look at one of the runbooks that I have available today, and let's see what that looks like. Okay, I'm back in Orchestrator, and I remember I brought in a particular runbook that I've looked at, and this particular runbook I want to it's in my checkpoint management suite of runbooks that I have, and I have a number of different items here. So what you'll do whenever you want to create a runbook, and what I did in my case was actually create all of these objects, all these items, and created this step in workflow. But let's click into each of them, and you have all the parameters about the particular object itself. And in this particular checkpoint management process, I'm going to initiate a checkpoint management property here. And one of the things I want to pay attention to is I have an action to remove or restore here. And you have a number of different other points that you can call to here and identify. But first thing I want to do, I'm going to then go in and get a VM. And I'll notice that I have a number of VM attributes that I can pull from. And I have a number of clouds here that I can leverage to do that, and I want to identify which one of those VMs I want to use. Okay. So then I have a notification error here. Let's say I'm looking for a particular VM. If it's not available, I want to kick off an alert or an awareness, and I'll throw a warning saying, hey, I could not find this VM. It was not found. I don't have any information about this. Let's throw an alert, and then that triggers the next step for someone to actually investigate what may be occurring within this scenario. So then my next step is to I want to query and check for the checkpoint ID. I want to look for that name. I want to make sure that it's there. And if so, I'm going to get a checkpoint. I'm going to get that checkpoint name, and that's what you see here. And in this particular one, you can see information about the name, about the run behavior, etc. And then lastly, there's the pass-through in which I will then use a power, you'll notice I have used PowerShell scripting here, and I can take advantage of a number of different languages here to write my PowerShell script. And I've already created something here that allows us to pass those properties through and then execute on creating that checkpoint and managing a checkpoint of that VM. So that's kind of the process that you go through when you think about what are the steps that my users are going to, that my IT staff is going to have to do throughout the day when they want to deliver this resource or deliver this service, and you've created the steps to do so. So let me go into Service Manager. I want to take a different perspective. If you've been through some of the earlier sessions on Service Manager and automating these tasks, we created this runbook. Now within Service Manager, I want to take advantage of those runbooks that I've created. So within my library, I click on runbooks, and you see I have a number of runbooks, and those are the same ones you just saw in Orchestrator. So I have a number of different runbooks that I've created here. And let's say, for instance, VM management, I have a change VM status. That's one of the runbooks that I have available here to me that I've already created, that I've already taken advantage of, and it looks in the form of a runbook automation And you'll notice some information about the virtual machine name, the action type for that virtual machine, if there's some additional offerings that I'm going to build around, who am I going to allow to take advantage of changing or managing a VM as one of the steps. Here's where I will do it, and I'll create this runbook automation. Now, when I want to do this, and I'll just kind of walk through what this looks like, whenever you create a runbook automation activity, it'll come show up in the form of a template. And you want to make sure that you identify the class of this particular template is a runbook automation activity. So I'll have one, and I'll say test runbook automation activity. I'll click OK, and it brings up the form. And I've already created some of these, and there's a number of steps that you'll need to go through to actually create this, but you'll want to apply a name for this. Name for this activity. You want to make sure that it's ready for automation. You can also identify a number of different ancillary information about it in terms of the area and the stage, who's it's assigned to, designer, etc. But I want to step into the runbook itself and look at what is actually what do I need to map within this runbook and what do I want to perform. And you want to have some mapping activities in terms of the action type, as well as a virtual machine manager. You can map what next steps or what information needs to be called. And you'll notice the runbook that I've actually chosen is the change VM status. I built this runbook in the runbook designer. I've connected to this runbook within Service Manager, and now I see it as a runbook automation activity, and that's one of the number activities that you see that I've listed here where I can perform software inventory. I can deploy software updates, I can create a collection, delete a collection, etc. A number of these steps were already the runbooks that I created. How did I connect to them? I made sure that within administration is where I want to make sure that I'm connected to all of the necessary components within my environment. And you'll notice one of my connection points is Orchestrator. And I have my Orchestrator connector here, which makes sure that I'm synced and I'm pulling in all the necessary runbooks that I have within my environment. So that's how that would be applied there. Another thing here is in my library. Again, we've talked about what the request offerings look like. If I'm inside of any of my request offerings, I want to go look at one of my offerings that I've already created. Let's take update virtual machine. I want to open that up. Okay. And you'll notice that, again, I've created a template for this based on the type of activity that I want to run. And this is where that template is now connected to that request offering. And again, that request offering is now within the service offering. These templates that are here, are a number of the different templates that I've created and where I can apply my runbook and the necessary activity that I want to create. So let me test template. Let's say I want to apply this to a service request because these are the types of requests I want my users to make, and I want them to use the runbooks that I've already created. I want to build them into this process automatically. I click OK. All right, I create my form and I identify who the respective users are. Let's say, for instance, I have my administrators here. I have some information about the urgency of a given request or activity. Let's say if it's something I'm doing all the time, it's pretty basic. It's not critical to performance. I could call it low, and the priority could be low as well. But activities is a big one where I start to bring in the activities from the runbooks themselves. And I've created some templates here. I have some runbooks that I want to take advantage of. And let's say default review activity is one of the activities that I have. When this comes up, this is now all of the attributes of the runbook activity that I want to start to connect and bring together for the process of automating the tasks that are coming from Orchestrator. And this is where you will actually step in and perform these tasks and apply it to the change request itself. And you'll notice that I've created a number of these already. I have these request templates that I've already created. For instance, I wanted to add a new user group. It is a service request, and I've been able to apply that template to a request offering and then allow that request offering to then be applied to a service offering. And you'll notice the runbook activities are here, and you'll see the runbook activity that I want to take a look at is here for adding a user group. And I've attached all of the actual items or the objects that I'm going to need to map or that have already been mapped for the process of performing those tasks. So this is the full cycle that you'll actually go through when you want to create a runbook, when you want to create a runbook and apply it to a process. You'll use Orchestrator within Runbook Designer. You'll then ensure that you have connectivity. You'll build that runbook with all of these object items on the right, whether it be third-party tools or assets within the System Center suite already. You'll create a workflow of processes. You'll then map those processes to the runbook and the workflow itself, and you'll ensure that you have the runbooks available to you within Service Manager. And when you're in Service Manager, you'll then use the request offerings and service offerings to automate that process and deliver that experience through the self-service catalog or the self-service portal. And that is the process of using system automation to create a self-service experience to resolve issues as well as deliver services to your environment. So thank you again for joining us at this Microsoft Virtual Academy session on automation self-service, specifically the system automation component and how we deliver services with Orchestrator and Service Manager. Moving forward, we want you to definitely go back to TechNet Evaluation Center and download System Center 2012 R2 and try Service Manager and try Orchestrator and get your hands on it. We also want you to take advantage of a lot of the hands-on technical labs that we've built within a self-paced environment so that you can evaluate this experience online. We have unique scenarios that we've built, and we want you to try those out and walk through the steps and learn how to do this yourself. Lastly, we want you to come back to Microsoft Virtual Academy and join us for our following sessions on process automation and integration within automation self-service, as well as the rest of the System Center 2012 R2 capabilities. Again, thank you for joining me, and come back to Microsoft Virtual Academy.